Robin, and I'm the drummer in Bush.
Yeah, I'm Dave, and I play bass.
Nigel, guitar.
I'm Gavin, I sing, play guitar, and travel around the world.
Maybe find another lover. Should I fly to Los Angeles? Find my ass a brother.
A rock band out of England. It's our passport to get into somewhere like Hong Kong, come into Asia. Rob has been to Asia before, but on a holiday, I think. So I never would have had a chance ever to come here, probably ever to come to Australia, wherever we've been. So it's our ticket out, our passport. Nigel and I met through a friend of ours who's a singer in a band. We met at a gig she was having, and we first started jamming and working together on New Year's Eve, wasn't it? It was New Year's Eve day, playing stuff. That's what we did. Yeah. And then we knew them. Alex, my flatmate, is friendly with someone that knows him, so that's how he came involved, and I knew Dave.
You look really massive there, look. You're pregnant.
Putting on weight rapidly.
Yes, there's all this fresh food out here.
Yeah, the rest is history, you know. It was 5 years ago. We just started rehearsing and here we are. This is as far as we've got so far.
Hong Kong, on the top of a tram.
Yeah.
Top of the world, Mark.
But we're not knocking it. Story really. Yeah. There's a sort of flippant comment that's got a bit out of hand. So, although, you know, that's more of a reflection on the fact that we all had to do some pretty ordinary, mundane jobs to get ourselves through the early days of.
It was originally from the biography. How do you write a biog that has some kind of interest? And it was meant to be that we met on London Bridge. We were all painting London Bridge and we met, and you know, it's like not even that funny particularly, but it's a lot more funny than we met as painters, you know, it's so dumb. And for some reason,
it's come back to haunt us again.
No, I mean, we're over it now. It doesn't really happen that much, but it was for a while really annoying, you know. Everywhere we turned, he was like, you know, so we hear you guys are house painters. No, that was just we were bored and didn't want to write in the bio, you know.
Now here comes a lie, we will always be true.
I worked on art departments, doing sets, painting sets, building sets. I did commercials, different stuff. But like, I have different friends of mine that would be charitable and give me jobs because they knew I couldn't afford to eat very well. So they would give me jobs, short-term jobs, so that I could, you know, never ever sway from music. We'll be right back.
done so wrong from the start, you know, like releasing a record or a single getting played on the radio before it was available. You know, all that stuff, you know, we hadn't even shot a video and already our single was kind of being played all over the radio. There was no press about us. So the whole thing was really born from a desire to want to play our music on the radio. So we were always catching up from then onwards, you know. We never had, our press pack always was about this thick, you know. This had not, we were, you know, we never caught up with it. So this is why we do stuff like this now, try and redress it a little bit, get people to understand a bit more about us, you know, maybe at the back end of the record.
Being homeless in Los Angeles and couch hopping around different places, not having any money, not having any future, and being on a sort of a on a difficult plane. And it, you know, it was written before I had any idea that we were gonna launch out, get an American record deal or launch out in America. It was just another song that I'd written. And it worked out kind of ironic that the first record that we had out had the whole thing of living in Los Angeles, because it just came about. Synchronicity. Fate. I believe in fate heavily, as opposed to, you know, something contrived.
Was there really a brother that you didn't like very much?
There was that whole mentality that I didn't like very much with some of it. You know, that's all. It's a really a cliched view of Los Angeles, and I think LA has a lot more to offer than the people. I mean, I think that physically up and down the coast or whatever, it's really pretty, and up in the mountains and the hills rather, you know, really, really lovely. So it's not like I want to diss LA, because I think it's got a lot of good points, but obviously there are kind of certain elements to it that that contain assholes.
Catch us on
Ander.
That's Ander
there, Dave.
Hi, we're Bush.
Alienation, in the classic sense, and that's what comes through in the video. See Gavin wandering through, like, sort of there but not there.
Yeah,
and I know that feeling quite well.
Here you said you would love to try some. Here you said you would love to die some. In the middle of a world on a fish. Look, you're the wave, you're the wave, you're the wave.
I get to play guitar and bass.
Debut.
First time ever in a video I'm playing guitar,
bass
and drums.
We've got lots of friends in there, lots of people we know.
That was part of the vibe, was that, you know, because of the way the song is about alienation, it was interesting to have people in who were friends, and, you know, it was just a really...
It's really good to get your friends in and then ignore them.
Yeah. And yet not.
Yeah. Made them wait around 12 hours.
I chew my weak rhyme, spit a wine. Pour the world up.
Blaze Blaze Suitcase is meant to be the idea of, I'm trying to think of a better way of saying it other than emotional baggage, because I'm bored of saying emotional baggage, but that's what the vibe is, the whole thing of the agenda that people bring to a situation, whether it's private, whether it's work, whatever, and you're always having to deal with other people's agendas as opposed to people coming to it
fresh and clean, and you know, so it's that really.
He's very informed, he reads a lot, so he would have heard us. Of course, he had not studied our record, but as soon as we asked to work with him, I think he went out and checked out the record and saw what the band was about a little bit and agreed to work with us.
The fact that he's a musician too, you know, so many producers. Or, you know, Steve's not actually a producer. That's one thing he would like to get straight. He believes in just recording bands. He doesn't believe in his input in any other way than the mechanics of making your sound get onto tape, basically. So he you know, he's a musician, and we respect his records as much as we respect his ability as an engineer. So it was a combination of the two.
There's a terrible wind problem.
His whole thing is like he uses really brilliant old mics, old valve mics. His microphones look like really crazy, big old RCA mics. They're all made 50, 20, 30 years ago, whatever, vintage mics. And his miking technique is what gives him his you know, true sound. Because I mean, he works with so many different bands, and say, you know, the Jesus Lizard to Palace or something, Smog. These kind of bands, one is a really heavy, heavy rock band, another being a really heavy bummer band. You know, so he runs the whole thing. For me, Pod and Breeder's first record, the way that you could hear every squeak of all the guitars, the vocals, the way he recorded Polly's vocals, you know, I just always loved that. David Yao, his Lizard, obviously, is like way down in the mix and just sounds like, but that's his vibe, you know. And Steve's got, you know, really good at recording stuff.
We've certainly learned a lot of lessons about playing as a band together. We've discovered the dynamic range that the band has currently, and we just tried to reflect that. Steve's a great engineer to use in that department, because he'll capture anything, the breathing, he'll capture the quiet as well as the loud, you know. And we obviously discovered our dynamic whilst on tour, and that's the thing we really wanted to get across, was like how we play together as a band, you know. And so that's what I would hope this album is a reflection of, more than anything else. It's obviously a collection of great songs, but, you know, it's also there's also some really good performances there too.
Yeah.
achievement to do that record, in the sense that we've been working so much and so hard and so long it was. The tour was originally going to be 5 weeks long. We booked Steve at a certain point. It turned to 3.5 months. Suddenly we were right backed up. You know, we had to get new songs together. So in itself, this is an achievement. I'm just happy that we managed to get through it, you know.
Actually, traveling in a tram through Hong Kong was one of my lifetime achievements.
And Jim will fix it.
I don't know where I go from here.
I think it's nice to collaborate with people. I mean, that's the nice thing, the position we're in. We can go off individually and collaborate, or as a band, with different people.
What are you trying to say?
Neil, if you're out there.
BTV's got it first. Look, Nigel's off on a jazz odyssey.
Interesting
is that we have, you know, always at the front it's much younger, and then the gradient goes up. I mean, when I was in America at one point, when I was really sick, I had a guy, ear, nose and throat specialist, looking down my throat, and he said to me, you know, I don't want you to think that you only have a younger audience. I've done 3 tonsillectomies to your CD today. And apparently he operates playing 16 stone. I wonder if Razorblade Suitcase might not be so, you know. Stitch him up, put him on. Razorblade Suitcase, here it comes, turn it up.
It's a cartridge chair.
But one thing that we're really careful about and very much into, certainly I am, is the thing of I would never condescend because there's younger people. You know, music when I was 11, 12 was really important to me. You know, I loved those bands, and if I figured that they were looking down on me like some stupid little kid, you know, in their way, you know.
Teenagers start everything, you know. They've started every single piece, every single important piece
nice
of music
when the girls
has come.
Are slightly older, though. Don't let the days go by. Could have been easier on you. I couldn't change though I wanted to. Should have been easier by 3. Open fear with you and me. Don't let the days go by. Being out on the road, you go through everything from the greatest highs to the lowest lows, because you have to live like normal life when it's not normal life at all. You know, everything still affects you in certain ways, and obviously the more successful you get, the more people want to pull you left, right, center, back, forward. And you know, if you don't comply in any way, then you get seen as pissy and moody and difficult, when, you know, maybe you're just wanting 5 minutes to yourself. So it's pretty hard for that. And obviously, everyone misses whoever they live with. We're really spoiled and really lucky because we have great audiences and great shows. CBGB's when we first began, the first gig, because of the history of the place, Patti Smith and all of that, obviously, that went on there. And that's when it really started to go off, and we knew something was going on. And then there's been so many brilliant big shows and small shows that, you know, we've just been spoiled, really. Red Rocks was great. Nassau Coliseum, I mean, we played everywhere, Universal Amphitheatre. The mind is all, it's everything. Ooh.
people say we love is skin wearing. You're retrograde. You're a vacancy. Oh, the one I love. You'd hate me.
There's a sort of chaos theory that whenever we have to do a TV show, there's always major problems with the transport beforehand. We've had the bus catch fire. We had, when we did the David Letterman show, we literally our flight was cancelled. We had to do a show and then fly from LA to New York. Flight was cancelled because we were supposed to go on a, you know, one hop, you know, so we could all go to sleep. It was then cancelled. We then had to do two separate flights, so no one slept at all. And it's happened on, I'm trying to think of some of the other occasions where we just, it's just a thing that follows us. Whenever we do TV.
Bus caught fire.
Yeah, stuff happens all the time. It's, and it's funny because we always, and people say, you guys are really tired. It's like, yeah, it's every time. You know, well, yeah, of course we're tired. We didn't sleep again before TV.
Ones, I think, one of the first live transmissions around, right around the world.
Really jammed it up, totally caused chaos. It was a really interesting thing to do, you know. It's difficult because at the moment of technology with the visual side of it, you can only sort of use like stills and then impose another still. You can't actually broadcast, like you can do the audio, but the visual's still a bit kind of sluggish. You know, but maybe
it wasn't bad though.
It wasn't
a little bit body. We look like we like really good body pop dancers,
yeah.
You know, that's
we got like,
yeah, can't we do it now?
It moved every so often.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I mean, when think of it, we were in a recording studio in Harrow, off the Harrow Road or around there, West 11, being broadcast all around the world playing. And it was wicked. And what the weirdest thing was when we finished the songs. Because you finish it, it's obviously silence. Upstairs, there was a big room with everyone singing. But we're down in the studio, we're like, finish the songs, like, as everyone says, oh, the 6 million people were still watching. All right, okay.
We're
right, cool. I was introducing it. We were just like saying, whatever, you know, we're going to play this song now. Because like a show, normally you go bang, hit next song, but we were a bit more low key.
No longer sane, no longer human. You're everything to me. And pray for rain just to make it sunny. It's better now.
That's one thing we're really looking forward to, the actual total, yeah, we've done like sporadic tours of America and Europe and da da da. And now we're going to actually, you know, embark on getting across all the, you know, across the world basically over the space of 18 months.
Also, so, you know, artistically you're always trying to, you can never make the perfect record, you know, you can be proud of what you've done, but I think the day that you think that you've made the best record or whatever is the, probably the last time you make a record. You know what I mean? You really have to keep on. It's an onward journey for me writing songs. You know, it's still frustrating because I still feel that there's much, you know, better stuff obviously to do, and which is cool, much better. Figure that when you're in England, the kind of ceiling for a successful band is possibly being reasonably well known in Europe, selling really good things in England, touring up and down the country. The idea when you start a band and you're rehearsing in a small dingy little studio that you're going to be sitting on top of a bus and a tram in Hong Kong, or you're going to be traveling to Japan or touring Asia, touring America, it just doesn't really compute. You don't think like that, so everything's a shock.